does kind of get old.
Becomes gray.
Well, I mean,
it does become, it is very bizarre.
I'm so sorry.
I absolutely love George Michael and Wham with all my heart.
You could also...
When I get requests for things like Baker Street, best type.
Oh my god, let me see.
Yeah,
somebody has to hum the tune. I play by ear and then by memory once I play the song. Oh, wait.
Take like 15 minutes before that and be like, hey, I could have
That's a very good point.
Yeah, definitely. I feel like fursuiters often miss that. You have to grab water, drink it.
Hey,
this is my poetry work.
Yeah,
it's got
people that love her.
He's got a big
scoop.
Wow.
Yeah. Well, there's my microphone, isn't there? So
wow.
It's impressive.
No, I'll actually be covering something like that for a later topic, but that's a good example of
this is why I play suits. I
did. Yes. Also, under my dragon is in Zephyr as well. I only talked to him online a couple times, but he's awesome. So go check him out with Zephyr tonight. Also, we have Adler the Eagle over here. You might recognize him from YouTube and Twitter. He's been posting a lot of really cool videos and animations and stuff like that. And I'm totally jealous.
I don't play an instrument. Well, I play trombone, but I don't know how much you have to But I've had a lot of experience with being in suit and other facets of my life, which will probably go over eventually.
Yeah. Alright, so now, a part of knowing your limits, it's definitely staying hydrated, it's staying rested. Like, I mean, I know at conventions everyone's like, oh, I'm gonna just stay up all night and drink, and then why do I have a headache next morning? Why did I wake up at 3 p.m.? Oh, the panels are already over? Crap, I guess I'll drink some more. But it's more than that. It's if you want to actually get serious about performing on stage, it's literally a lifestyle change. You'll have to probably change your diet, you'll have to change your sleeping habits. It takes a lot of dedication as far as practice time and preparation, stuff like that. But knowing your limits is the biggest thing that I've had, because you have to know when to call it quits. You have to know when you're on that brink of, like, it's not worth the effort of pushing through when you're already, like, ready to pass out. You need to take that break. If you can't recognize when your body's telling you to stop, then maybe you should rethink your thinking.
No, that's very important.
Yes, yes.
Are you performing tonight?
Yes, I am, actually.
Oh, my
goodness. You're watching Levi Family.
Yeah. It's going to be interesting. Let's see. Okay, so aside from knowing your limits, that's the biggest thing. Like, that everything that we'll be basically going over is part of knowing your limits.
I've got a good example of that.
Sure.
A couple years ago, I was at Anthropon, my first Anthropon. Probably Viking invasion. And I wanted to fursuit in the parade, but I also wanted to play my saxophone. And the only reason I decided to do it was because I knew I had marching band experience. If I had not had that marching band experience and know exactly when I should stop playing and march for a little bit, take my breath, take breaks, I would have been probably on a stretcher halfway through the parade. This is the first time that the parade went outside.
Oh, yeah.
So I'm used to really, really thick marching band outfits, a really tight hat, blazing lights, people.
Oh, by the way, did you introduce yourself?
I'm Tech the Skunk, and probably recognizing from Anthropon, I've been walking around with a saxophone sometimes.
Hi, Tech!
Hi. I believe you're so friendly, though. I'm just here as a special guest to my good friend, Joey.
Sure. And it was great to have you. But definitely, like, when it comes to my music training, I only had, like, maybe 2 years of band in middle school, and then I realized I hated trumpet.
I've played it for about a year. It's very loud.
I don't see you playing trumpet anymore, though.
I was always a French horn.
I was a 12-year-old me. Yeah.
Exactly. Oh. But yeah, once I kind of dropped out of band, that gave me, like, my first impression of, like, okay, this is what it takes to actually practice in middle piece. But then I moved on to picking up guitar and stuff like that, and actually learning music that I liked helped. So that's half the battle, is making sure you find out what works for you as far as, like, your interests, what you want to be about, that kind of stuff.
Well, like you were saying with band and marching practice,
that kind of training is built right into the study. I know every school basically has their marching groups and stuff like that, and they actually train you how to take breaths, they train you how to march in formation,
yep.
They train you to, you know your limits.
Yep.
So that's exactly a good point to bring up.
I make it a personal rule that whenever I'm marching for a long parade, like the one at MFF, or the one here, MTFC, and the one at AmberCon, I make it a point to drink at least 2 to 3 glasses of water right before the parade. Right before.
Oh, yeah.
Like, if they're lining up for the picture, I'm drinking those glasses of water then. Because I want to be hydrated, so I want to play my instrument. Two, I want to have that cool core inside my suit. For when I'm walking, I'm going to heat up really fast. 3, it's always good to stay hydrated. That's the number one rule that caught you in parking maker.
Definitely. And, that's the other thing, is that, like, when, especially when it comes to hydration, what would you rather have? Would you rather feel like you have to use the bathroom for a little while, or, you know, pass out completely flushed? I mean, it's kind of a toss-up. I mean, if you got a weak bladder, I understand, but... At the same token, you know, having the urge to use the bathroom is kind of better than, you know, passing out.
You want to sweat it out anyway. So.
Exactly. And then like today, it doesn't even matter if it's like below freezing temperatures outside. Your body is going to do what your body does. So staying hydrated is number one. All right. So now after like knowing your limits. One of the things that I found out that I didn't think of to begin with, especially when I started pouring, venue awareness. Half the battle is just knowing where you need to be and when you need to be there. I've had several times now over the past couple years where I've showed up to the place where I thought I needed to be, and then realized, that's several blocks over this way. And I was in suit at the time, so I'm like, oh crap, I have to grab my amp and guitar and walk myself over there. So the sooner you can figure out the plan of like where things are, when things are happening, that will help you definitely in the long run. But more about venue awareness is knowing how they're going to structure your performance. Even today, I've been doing this for a couple of years now. Even today, I still have to do sound check. I still have to do going over my set list and things like that. It's a lot of prep time, and you need to communicate with the people that are running the event. And a lot of times, I have volunteers that kind of switch out between staff members. So the person you set up with the day before probably might not be the same setup person that you meet the day after. And that was an interesting situation back at Indie FurCon where we had 2 different rehearsals for a talent show, and then finally the day of, none of the people involved except for the sound guy, even then, like, everyone was different people. So they had no idea what was going on, and while I was half in suit, I was running around on stage helping them plug stuff in 15 minutes after the show was supposed to start. So, be prepared for delays, be prepared for dealing with people you haven't even talked to before, even after you've planned everything out. I don't know if you guys, especially Zephyr, has had any experience with that kind of stuff.
Well, we have, but he wasn't part of it.
Oh!
Exactly.
If you want to come up, sure.
I've been in the band for 2 months. This guy's been in for 2 years.
Yes.
And still the worst player.
Although our second also has half your set list.
Well, I'll say that.
As this is Cobalt from Zephyr. Bass player and operatic singer.
Well, essentially, last year at FE, things were kind of a little, shall we say, hectic. Not knocking on the sound crew or anything, like they did everything that they could, but the main sound guy wasn't there at the time, and he had a prior engagement thing, like he couldn't get out of it, like totally understandable. It really, really helps to know what you want and where or what you need to set up before you get on stage to do that stuff. Like, for example, being a bass player is the best because you bring one instrument and you can usually DI, and then meanwhile these guys are setting up 672 pedals. wonderful. Or this guy has an entire drum kit.
Oh, see, that takes you just more time to look up memes on your phone.
See, that's what I'm doing. So, like, it works out. But, you know. Yeah. Like, my main suggestion is, one, have everything where it's, like, ready to go. Like, if you have cables that you need to set up, have your cables wrapped and ready to go. If you have your pedals in a separate space where you can just take them and pop them in, that's it. Like, do everything you can. Yeah. Like, do as a musician and actually a sound engineer myself for 3 years now, the more prepared that you are, the happier we are, because let me tell you, live sound is incredibly hard. Like, incredibly hard. I can't do it because I would jump off the tallest building in 10 seconds. I'm staying very comfortably in my studio. But
yes.
Anything you can do, like, especially for, like, the assistants, because a lot of them, you know, a lot of them, especially at conventions, are volunteers. Some of them don't even really know that terribly much about sound or about whatever you're doing. So it really helps to kind of give them as much help as you can just by setting yourself up before you get on. And obviously, you know, you get people, like, I think you're plugging here, this is great. Audie is like,
Audie
is the man, like, big time. Yes. And, like, you know, he knows what he's talking about, he knows what he's doing. You tell him, hey, can you do this?
Yeah, okay.
And he gets it done. Absolutely nothing but nice things to say. And, like, you know, it's a privilege to get them. But,
yes.
Like, you don't, but don't expect it. You know what I mean? Like, this audience not always going to be there. You're not always going to get that guy. So it really helps to be prepared before you walk in.
Definitely.
As someone who's also spent a lot of time in teams, big and small, the more prepared you can be for unpreparedness,
yes,
exactly. Get ready for the problems that hit you in the face.
Yep. Yeah.
I mean, it's going to crap out, this may work, it's not going to be pleasant, but it's more about preparation.
Like, go along with that. I'm kind of loud, but anyway. Go along with that, like, don't expect somebody to, like, bring you water. Like, don't expect, if you're like, oh, who's going to have water? Just do it yourself.
Yeah.
Like, if you're in your, like, afraid or, like, you don't know who's doing it, no one's probably doing it. Probably doing it.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
Being self-reliant is a big part of it. I know a lot of first-shooters have handlers and stuff like that, and more power to them for having that, you know, support group right there in case they need something. But a lot of times, especially up on stage, you're not going to have a handler. Like, sure, unless you make your handler part of your act, which I've seen some people do it. It's a lot of independent stuff that you're just like, this is just me out here. On my own. Shoot, I lost my train of thought. Yep, that's right. Another thing about venue awareness. The stage itself and the lighting. I know there's been a couple instances of, you know, fursuiters tripping and falling. Just like trying to get around chairs. Increase that to like 3 feet above the ground. And then you've got a hazard right in front of you, basically, if you were to stand on this table. Like, a fall from that could break an arm, a leg, bust a nose, you know, dislocate a shoulder, anything like that. It really comes down to making sure you have good spatial recognition, good depth of field when you're in suit. And if you don't, then make sure you're careful about where you stand.
Know your venue.
Yes, yes. Know your venue. Let's see. I know I actually had an instance last year at Indie Fur Con where I was running another little concert. I actually had to stop halfway through a song because they had the room lights down all the way, and the stage lights were basically spotlights right in my eyes. And especially with this suit, I like to think I have better visibility than most people, but a combination of spotlights not having any ambient light in the room, I couldn't even see where the heck my hand was on my guitar. I mean, it's hard enough to see, like, down past here, so I have to keep glancing where I'm looking, but the lights combination with the not lights in the room, I was like, hey, cut the music, I can't even finish the song. But luckily, they brought up the house lights, they parted the spotlights away from my face a little bit, and then we restarted the song, and everything worked out that way. not for lack of, you know, my practice of, you know,
blindfolded practice, because that would have helped.
And also, just on the note of kind of restarting performance as well, like, I still see live performances of obvious issues.
Yeah.
Like getting, and then you get a little song and be like, nope, it's so good, we're going to restart this. I mean,
yeah.
I remember seeing Tame Impala do the video recently. It's like, wow, they restarted it, and it was rock solid. It was great, so. How is it? There's no shame in having
mistakes happen. It's a live performance. It's a little thrill of it.
Yes.
You know, something you can do live.
Do live!
And that's the other thing. You have to know as a performer if it's worth restarting whatever you're doing. If you feel like you've flubbed beyond recovery, usually whoever's running the event will be like, okay, yeah, we can give you a restart on that. Like, you know, catastrophic failure, things falling apart, you falling on your face, forgetting lyrics, stuff like that. People are usually pretty good at that.
I wasn't in suit for this one, but my very first song, the very first show, exactly, I was on someone else's pit. And at the end, the ride cymbal, like the biggest 21-inch cymbal, just went,
oh no!
Just went totally vertical. Whatever, still played it. It was really short range, whatever. Kept going. Not really.
Yeah.
You do it live. You learn to improvise, you learn to manage, but you know you can do it physically, etc.
Oh yeah, that reminds me, the first ever talent show I performed was actually right here, back when this convention was FCN still, Freight Connection North. I can't remember exactly what year it was. Anyway, but my first ever talent show that was by myself, I started into the song R.E.M. by, no, song Man on the Moon by R.E.M. And two lines in, I'm like, I don't know these words. Oh crap. And like, I'm just like, oh my god, I forgot the lyrics. Everyone starts laughing. I start laughing because I'm like, oh, screw me. This was back when Bucktown Tiger was hosting the event. Like, hey, can you get the lyric sheet from my Guitar Case over there? And so he goes running off the stage, runs back up, and like, me and Mom just kind of sitting there, like, trying to remember the lyrics, and like, the crowd just starts going,
that's good.
That's
good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, that brings on many layers.
Yeah.
You know, it's funny. We started a trend too. Like, we own our mess ups. So when someone on stage or something, we just literally tell the crowd to go.
One note of a song, it means stop, which I did during FB, during Acrobatic Game. I just went, stop.
Yeah.
And then I had the whole crowd screaming, you fucked up at me. It was really silly.
Yes, I
was okay. I get the most of those, don't you worry.
Oh, man.
I have the luxury of having a backup when I'm at AnchorCon. When I mess up, they usually cover. But when I march here for MCFC, I mess up a song, everyone's going to hear it. And I just keep playing, just because I know that if I stop the song in the middle, people are going to be like, where's the rest of the
song? Yeah, why'd you stop?
So I just stop. Just keep going with it. If it's something small, minor.
Yeah.
For me, a lot of my music comes from playing by ear or just memorization from playing songs over and over again off of Spotify. Pull up a song I like, listen a little bit, toss a couple of raw notes here and there, and suddenly the song comes out of my back.
Yeah.
But really all it comes down to is stop the song, or stop whatever you're doing if you know that you can't recover the rhythm yet, or if you can easily pull off the recovery, just segue into something else. Like earlier, I was playing one song by Kenny D, I guess, and then I segued right into the Lugia theme from Pokemon 2000. So I couldn't get the rest of it, it would just be repetitive. Just go with the flow. Whatever the flow may be, even if it's a damn.
Yeah.
I also just like perform live music, which is amazing. I can't even imagine how you guys even do that.
We don't have
it. I was in a college mascot, and there have been the feet for this mascot were just horrible. They're terrible. I would run the flag every basketball game, like the very last flag is in Ball State, you know, like I'd run the last beat, literally a couple of like weeks ago, I'm running across and the foot just decides like, bye, woo, and flies off. And like, there's nothing worse, because there's no way you can like act about that.
Yeah.
And it's just kind of like, it's like, oh, crap. So I just ran over and like dropped the flag and just like really just laid into like, I goofed up. So I like found the nearest exit and was like, oh no, and like ran away and people loved it.
Yeah.
But it's funny because like what to me was like one of the most embarrassing things that's ever happened in my life.
Oh yeah.
Life.
Exactly.
It was hilarious for everyone else. I'm like, well, at least everything can happen.
And you know what else I think is a really good tip for anyone that has like performance anxiety or stage fright, or is just, you know, really worried about trying to put on a good show. The main thing that I found that helped, well, of course, you know, the first talent show I had, I screwed up and then I moved on. But I found out that the best way you can look at it is rationally think. What is the worst thing that could possibly happen if you were to screw up?
Yeah.
Somehow. like especially at a con, you're not going to get booed, you're not going to get heckled, and certainly you're not going to get kicked off the stage for screwing up.
At least people are drunk all the time anyway. So
exactly.
Part of the song.
Exactly. Exactly. But the other thing is that like it, you could apply this to any stressful situation. Take it to the most extreme. Take it to the most extreme. Real possibility that something could turn out in a bad way. And once you rationalize that is the worst result, realize that, you know, you still exist after this mistake. You still exist after whatever this is happened. I mean, barring that the worst outcome is that you are, like, violently hit by someone, which I seriously doubt anyone would run up on the stage and sucker punch. That's what I'm saying. Rationally take it to the worst place possible. And once you think about, hey, this is the worst thing that could possibly happen, realize that, like, hey, I'm still me, I'm still alive, I'm still functioning, I can do this. So that was like when I had first screwed up my first song, I was like, well, crap, the worst thing that could possibly happen, and here I am, finishing my song anyway.
Woo!
And it was a great learning experience, but it was basically tempered by choir, I guess. Oh.
Once you pick college, the worst, though, it only gets
worse. Can't see in the front.
Oh, yeah. Well, I can say in my 10 years of performing, most of the time, people, even when you're doing songs that are like really well known, most of the times people don't even realize that you messed up.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, like, you know you messed up right away. It's like, oh, god damn it. Just keep going. Just keep doing it. Because
it's like, if you do mess up, it's like, biggest thing is just, you know, own your mistake.
Yeah.
A good example of owning your mistake would be Good Riddance by...
Green Day.
Wow, I'm really bad. I was listening to it this morning. Literally in the beginning of the song.
Fuck.
Yeah.
Have you seen the vine that's like dun, dun.
Yes, I did.
Dun, dun, dun. Fuck!
Pardon my language.
I know it's so nice that this is like a 19 or 18 plus, right?
Something like that.
I believe so.
18 plus. Yeah. An adult con.
Yeah.
Nobody's got us in trouble.
I'm an adult. I'm dressed as a dragon.
But, yeah,
you
should
say.
Yeah, okay.
No, it's fine. I'm open for the discussion.
My train of thought went right through the back of my head. It's gone now.
Oh, okay. I apologize. I have that.
That's actually
good. Oh, good. We're only halfway through.
And I've almost run out of stuff.
Okay, so...
Okay, bring me on stage.
I know, I'm getting my back up, man.
Right, bring me on stage. I'll never shut up. You'll be kicking me out like at 4 o'clock.
It's okay.
All right.
So, in your guys' experience, we've had... your on stage club with the foot.
Yeah.
What was my club?
Oh, I have so many, it doesn't even...
Oh, well, see, like, yeah, well,
every time I march, there's a big flow. Every time. I don't usually... Like, I don't keep track anymore, but the big thing for me is every time I make a mistake, it's almost like a present for me now. I really feel like that, because I know what I need to be ready for next time.
Yeah.
My first time marching at AC, I was too nervous, I over-prepared, and I... took my entire case for my saxophone with me, a couple bottles of water, it's pretty heavy, throughout the entire however long parade.
Oh god.
I took a nap afterwards, that was really nice. Like,
I think you had a light.
After that, I didn't take my case with me. I left it in the corner with one of the door guys who usually keeps an eye on the room. And I always pull my water off of that. But after the parade, put the saxophone away, take it up to the room immediately. So I'm not going to want to play afterwards. I will be exhausted. And I'll just freeze it.
Yeah.
Sorry, a lot of my performances end up at AC because that's where I do a lot of the actual playing things.
Right.
Oh,
what?
Big subject.
Sure.
When you're performing in suit, not every instrument is super friendly. I just, fun story.
Okay.
So listen, I was a young scout. Decided I wanted to
when I was a young scout.
Mama told me.
Okay, but real talk, I decided to play my instrument. This suit I have is the same suit I started in, and it doesn't have a movie drum.
Yes.
Any suit I get after this to play instruments will have a movie drum, because out of pure, unadulterated love, my alto saxophone reaches just far enough inside for me to get a proper embouchure. That's the thing on the reading the mouthpiece. No other instrument. I just recently purchased a soprano saxophone for little baby guys, like half the size of the saxophone. Looking forward to suiting with it, realized that the soprano saxophone snack looks like that.
Yeah.
Yep. That's not going into my suit.
Yeah.
Not until I get a moving gun.
And that was another big topic that I actually wanted to cover, was making your suits work with whatever instrument or props you might be having. As you can see, if you guys wanted to look at any of this stuff, this was my original glove that I had when I started a couple years ago playing guitar and suit. As you can see, it's got like holes that are cut out in the fingers where the hand would come through. And it was just these green noodles hanging off the back of my knuckles, just like flopping around every time I would play. So instead I decided to get these guitar gloves. And the black part is actually a costume glove that I've cut the fingers off. As you can see, this is what it normally looks like. So you can repurpose a lot of stuff to work with as a costume. But this green bit underneath, this is actually a guitar glove made by a company from Canada, of all places. And it's from a website called originalguitarfingers.com. Not sponsored, by the way.
I'd like to be.
These guys are like $12 a pop, but honestly, the convenience of having this glove to play with, it's like amazing, because it's the difference between having my bare fingers out and just kind of, you know, having that partially broken magic, as opposed to, you know, keeping a magic look.
Keeping magic.
Shoni, did you make one too?
Yes, I did. Thank you.
That looks great. You really turned it hard. I'm impressed.
Oh, thank you. I'm not expecting everyone to have the skills of a fursuit maker, especially when it comes to customizing your suit for performance purposes. Especially like you were saying, having a moving jaw is literally half the battle of being heard. Sure, it makes whoever's making the suit, you know, go crazy trying to figure out how a face can fit or work with it. But it's the difference between, like you said, having the accessibility of your mouth and also being able to be heard. Not to mention also your vision as well. I know Ketchup Kitty over here can attest to a suit of hers, which was her 1.0 suit.
Oh, goodness, yes.
She basically, what the opposite of cross-eyed,
yes.
Like she had vision that was out to here. Like she couldn't see through both eyes at the same time. She had either looked through one or looked through the other.
Yep.
and it literally made her go like cross-eyed trying to see. If you can find a maker that's really good on making visibility a priority, that's another huge part of performing. Like really, the easier you can see on stage, it's like it makes everything really effective.
And this might be broken record for most fursuiters that had to use fursuits or thicker suits. Those cooling vests are a lifesaver. Really? I wish I had one, because every time I finish March, I'm always steaming. It doesn't matter if it's minus however many Michigan degrees out there it is. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter how hot it is. I'm always baking. Something.
Yeah,
just make it work.
Yes,
yeah.
You in the
front. All right, very
good. When they got outside just then in the parade, like, it felt like nothing happened. I felt like I was still inside. You know?
Yeah.
Sure, it was a funny little suit.
Actually,
yeah.
It depends. Actually, I would say this, and for you too, because you're a bit of a smaller build individual.
Yes, he was talking to me about
that. Don't get a body. You will go into shock as soon as you take off.
Yeah.
So I would suggest getting there are wristbands.
Yeah, the wristbands are nice
on there.
And
the neck one, even
the neck one.
Be careful.
So if you guys haven't heard about this kind of stuff, there's actually cooling devices you can get for your suit, which are basically they're kind of like flexible ice packs that you can put on your body. They help a lot. I haven't actually had the chance to try them out, but I know a couple of friends of mine have them, and they do like really help. The only problem is you have to be really, really careful how you wear them. Like he was saying, I know, have any of you guys heard of that little ear cap? Well, he was telling me about one time where he had this idea of putting an ice pack right on the back of his neck when he was out doing a parade. And it seemed to work, like he wasn't overheating to his knowledge. But when he got back inside and finally took it off his neck, he almost went into shock.
It feels cold, but
like your body putting it on the back of your neck is literally cutting off the signal to your brain that your body is overheated. So taking that ice pack off the back of his neck, all of that hit his brain at once, and he nearly passed out instantly. So you have to be really careful with that. Like he was saying, the best place to put it is on the wrist if you're a lighter fellow. But especially if you're a larger person, you can get away with the more full body suits and stuff like that because of the extra lining that
the Lord has
given. It helps me personally to have a lot of medical and military family members.
Right.
So I know exactly what my body can handle.
Yeah.
Don't ask me how. That's a story for another panel.
Okay.
Another panel.
Topsy.
Cooling devices are optional, but that's fine. Plus, you know your limits. You're pretty much good. I guess really the only suggestion I have is that in the thing you're using your prop, I'm going to call my baby a prop.
Yeah, instrument
prop.
Your instrument, your prop, is it's part of your suit, but at the same time, not every instrument or prop is for you. I see people walking around with giant swirly lollipops around the pond, and I'm like, that's a little bit hazardous, especially if you don't know how tall the door is, because you're holding onto that thing. And you walk through a door and you forget that you're holding onto this thing and
you will clothesline yourself.
Oh, I like that video of that dude that was coming off of a rig and he had a stick like this.
Yep.
Oh.
Yep. It's always very, very good to know what you're holding and how it interacts with your suit.
Oh, definitely.
I've never seen a flute player march in suit. Mainly because, step number one, because not a lot of people play as business suits. Number two, that needs a specific angle, a specific rotation, and this, even with a moving jaw, that's almost impossible.
Yeah.
Unless
like the jaw goes like all the way back from here.
Right.
Unhit your
Some horror first years.
Oh, geez. I see guitars and bass players. I see trombonists. I see trumpeteers, surprisingly enough.
That's surprising.
Anything with a relatively straight mouthpiece, or one that you can memorize fingering,
yeah.
Also very important. If you don't know your instrument, like the back of your hand, that's
new. Yeah.
If you don't know the instrument like the back of your hand, don't bother playing a suit until you can play blindfolded.
Yes.
Yep. It took me my entire saxophone career and this absolutely wonderful teaching in the Flutterby High School also. And the joy that comes out of playing your instrument just on a whim. Go home, I feel bored. I'm not good at video games, I don't play my instrument.
Yeah.
And you'll sit there and play it 1 hour past, another. It's bedtime. Another hour past. Now it's bedtime. Okay, one more song.
Yes,
Right.
And
it's
bedtime, like 5 hours ago.
Just the more you learn with what you want to do,
yeah.
And the fact that you want to share it with other people while you're in suit, even, that's the requirement, I think. Sharing what you love with the people around you.
Yeah.
Very, very much a requirement.
And I know a lot of this discussion is kind of centered around musicians specifically. I don't have much experience to. I've never like done any sort of dancing. I've never done any sort of like skit that required acting or anything like that on stage. But a lot of the same rules apply to knowing the limits of yourself, knowing the limits of your costume, especially if you're going to be moving around a stage a lot. You have to be able, especially if you're trying to put out a really good performance, you have to know, like, practice in front of a mirror. Realize what you look like in suit. Sure, you have to, like, look down a bunch to make sure you're not going to step off the stage or make sure you have good footing. But as long as you can make those glances just, like, part of your movements, it becomes a lot less obvious that the person up on stage is, like, looking like he's walking a tightrope. You know what I mean?
Being comfortable with what you're doing is a super, super, super vital thing. You
should
have gotten all that degree. You
would have
any
answer.
Yeah. I do want to build on one last point.
Sure,
sure. Just about being able to just, like, when you own your path, you want to share it with the person. I think at that point, it's okay to, we're going to hold ourselves as our standard of our work. But as far as how the audience is perceiving the performance, I think it should be a much less of a concern. We already trust ourselves with skill. We can do this in front of people at that point, because whatever happens, happens. Whether you're again, you're going through long notes, maybe people think you're good. Maybe
right.
You have a thought that's how it went, but you can't be caught up and that's just simply wrong.
Yes.
There you go. So,
Odin. Oh, yeah, definitely.
I have an idea. Listen to it.
And that's the other thing, is that like I've been involved in talent shows and stuff, especially at conventions where people will literally make up something on the spot, having not practiced at all. Well, see, if you're good at improv, do improv, like, by all means. But there are some people that I've run into that they think they know improv, but they have no idea what they're doing. And I've seen people just kind of stumble through a talent show submission, and people, like they're done, they bow, they walk off the stage, and everyone's like, what the heck was that? Like, I think you owe it enough. If you're going to be, if you're going to put yourself on stage, at least know what you're doing before, or at least practice your improv if you're planning on improv.
I would go back to the acting on stage and stuff. I think
sure.
One of the biggest things to remember, like when you're in suit, is that most likely someone's watching you. Which is kind of like scary, but at the same time, like I always try to stay in character like, all the time.
Right.
If I'm just sitting here, I'm like, okay, I'm still happy. Like, you know, like I always try to stay in character. So like, there's nothing worse than like somebody who can tell, like, like what I mean, like,
yeah.
I always, you know, like when you're acting, you know, always try to stay in your character, stay true to your character. And obviously, you need to go take a break, like,
yeah,
you know, somewhere, but like, really, you know.
try to stay in character.
Now, see, that's interesting you bring that up, because there's two different camps of thought with that. There's the one where you have an entire personality, an entire way of movement, an entire way of talking in suit that may not be anything like what you might be out of suit. Which is perfectly, like, by all means, if you want to reinvent yourself through your fursuit, go ahead and do it. That is, like, half the reason for it. But one thing that I make sure to do, especially with this character and with, you know, what I do up on stage, like, this is me. I don't really act differently out of suit than I do in suit. Like, I try to be as, like, genuine as possible. I'm not going to be coming up to someone like, hey, man, I'm the freaking rock and roll dragon. Like, no, that's
how you're going to be.
Yeah, no. Don't get me wrong, I have total respect for putting on a character like that, but I know me, I know my limits, I cannot maintain that.
And that's your character.
Yeah.
Like, essentially, I mean, you are your character, so like that, and that's totally cool.
Yeah.
You're still living true to the character that you have.
Right.
Definitely. I had to,
I was going on, but I don't
know. Yeah. Be flexible. We're actually pretty good on time, we survived like 15 minutes.
maybe a question
around. Yes!
Yeah,
exactly. If there's anyone in the audience that might have a question or a topic to bring up, this is open discussion, if you'd like to talk about anything. Anyone that might be interested in possibly doing a channel show or performance in the future, by all means, ask us anything.
Maybe you're nervous and you want some advice or something.
If you're not comfortable talking about it in like an open forum like this, you can approach us afterwards at any time, and we'll talk to you in person if you want. Yes, Cobalt.
I don't shut up, but body language in suits, because your face doesn't do any expressions.
Yes.
Very true.
Oh, when I first started suiting, I would look like Charlie Brown, just kind of derping along. But nowadays, I exaggerate every movement, especially when I'm playing my saxophone, or even when I'm not. If I wave to someone, I'll draw it out. I'll make it really extravagant. I feel like the fursuit just accentuates that.
Yep.
Makes it so much cooler, I think.
Yeah.
That's why I love suiting. So.
Oh, yeah. You have to remember, your suit is bigger than you are, so your movements need to be bigger than you yourself. You are in a suit, and it doesn't move the same way that you're normal.
Right, exactly.
Unless you're already like a naturally animated person, like Adler over here.
Yeah.
But, like, he doesn't have to exaggerate barely at all.
Yeah, we're already there. So
that's the point
okay.
When you become a human wrecking ball.
Okay.
No crowd killing at a break.
Right. That's a story for Kage and the rest of them, and more stories, right?
Oh, jeez.
Oh, boy. That's fun. No question? Oh, so.
Yes.
Yeah.
So this is just more of a technical question, because
sure.
This panel, I can hear all of you very clearly without muffled distortion.
Wow.
How are you doing that without like feedback in your mic system?
Big mouth, diaphragm speaking. Yeah. There you go.
Well, honestly, I don't know who set this room up.
Okay.
So they would have the answers.
Okay.
But as far as like, well, part of the reason that you get feedback is because the sound is bouncing back to the microphone. We're behind the PA speakers,
yep.
So that's half the reason. Once you get in front of a speaker and you have a signal that's going through the mic, out to the system, through the sound system, and back to the speaker, that's exactly what feedback is.
Yep.
Let's see. I've had instances where up on stage, like in the main events room, they'll have monitors that are at the front of the stage so that the performers can hear what's going on. Sometimes you have to compensate, making sure you don't get too close to those. Because once you get a microphone closer to the PA, it'll start feedbacking on its own. There's really, unless you have some really good software to counteract that, it's like, you know, blow a speaker out.
I have the habit of cupping my mic as well.
Bad!
Sorry.
I mean, I know you need to be heard a little bit.
Cupping
the mic is a cardinal sin when it comes to vocals.
Because if you do this, it like hops out. the definition of your voice.
Yeah, I just really love it. So it kind of works out in my favor. When I record the podcast, he does it open.
Yeah.
He's real good about it. He's got a pop filter and everything. He's real fancy. He hasn't recorded a single thing because he has to soundproof his room.
Oh, no.
Basically, yeah. Number one thing, if you want to soundproof your sound free, he's going to kill me if he found out I call it soundproofing. Sound 3 days in the room, start with bass traps in the corner. Start with bass traps in the corner. If anything, if you want to sound free your room, only bass traps, if you can only afford one.
Yeah.
Don't just grab eggshell foam and stick it on the wall. You're going to get that weird bass.
Oh, like me.
But seriously, like, big, deep, it doesn't even have to be, like, foam. They have, like, you can probably get thin plastic panels and just cover up those corners.
Yeah.
Because it'll catch that bass
resonance
in there. And trap that so that you can get that clear tone.
Before I forget, really quick, the whole art of using a microphone in suits. Especially with mine, I know I kind of worked out with my design. I had a very wide open mouth, so I have a very functional range where this microphone will still pick me up. But as opposed to like your mouth is a lot tinier, a lot closer.
So I tend to hold my mic right here on the corners of the mouth.
Yeah.
So if I talk to
that, and especially now we've got underbite over here. Now, they're also, especially if you're working with the more high-end audio equipment guys that especially attend these conventions, a lot of the time you can get away with a wireless microphone that sometimes they will have available. If you plan on doing this stuff, kind of stuff in suit, and you know that a microphone isn't really your best option, they can hook you up with a wireless mic that will fit inside your mask. I've had them actually do it for me a couple times, and it takes like a lot of the guesswork out of like, where the heck is my face, as opposed to like bumping the microphone when I'm trying to look for it. It's no guarantee that you'll get this equipment, because it's expensive equipment, and they only have like limited numbers of them. But if you were to contact any convention you plan on performing at in suit and ask the audio team or the people in charge if you can request them to rent one for the convention, that is an awesome option. I would highly suggest that. Let's see. Not all fursuits can accommodate the wireless kit. So it also matters if you have just a little open pocket next to your face to fit it. If you have a very enclosed head, if you have a very tight fit head, the wireless mic may not work for you. So it's a lot of planning just into your fursuit that you have to think about just being able to be heard, let alone being able to see out of the thing.
You just want to feel like he's in the CIA. Yeah.
These are all design things that you need to consider with your fursuit. These are all problems we're going to solve before we do the
end. Yeah.
Hi.
I need to need this thing.
Okay.
Don't drop the mic, the one that's missing.
Not just in pursuit, but also with your particular handicap as well.
Yeah.
So, for those of you who don't know, I'm legally blind. I have absolutely no vision in my left eye, and then I have 2400 in my right eye. So, basically half pursuit vision and then half of that. So, I use a few unique techniques on stage. Obviously, straight up, I can't tell, you know, I can't assume what I look like and try to manage that, you know, stage performance. There's no way of looking in the mirror and being like, okay, I just have to assume that, okay, this doesn't look terrible. He's not falling over, that's a plus, so you're not tripping over anything, so that's a plus. So I try to make that my main priority. So if you ever catch me, if I possibly can, I attend conventions and I get here on Sunday night. And the reason is because I would go into the rooms that I know that I'm going to be doing a panel or performing in.
Thursday night?
And, yeah, Thursday night. Yeah. I'll get here like almost a week early, you know?
But anyway,
on Thursday nights, and what I'll do is I'll go especially like to main events and things like that where there is a stage. I will memorize what door I'm going to go in and know roughly how many steps. For me, it is from there to the stage. So I have to map it out in my mind and I will go, like for main events, I know that for me, it takes me 19 steps to get from the top of the stairs to the end. And if I go that far, then there's going to be stairs right across. I know that it takes me only 7 steps to get from the far back of the stage all the way to the front, and then I'll fall off. So that way, I can kind of memorize, okay, you know, when I do a song with him later today, I'll know that, okay, I can, you know, walk about 7 or 8 steps, and I know that I'm about mid-range. So I have to kind of map it out in my mind since I have no visual preference on that.
Sightseeing the master.
That's
going to
be a lot of concentration.
Yeah. I was going to say, to do that and also... Like,
and play? Yeah.
At the same time. That's awesome.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
That's probably the other issue for me. I know how to read music, but I prefer to learn by ear. It's just a lot easier, a lot less issue. So I tend to listen to the music and then memorize it. I have forgotten the lyrics before.
Oh shoot, I forgot the lyrics last night before we went
out. There's no lyrics used as well. You know what happened. So yeah, that's pretty much how I tend to do things on stage.
You're awesome, man.
Not at all. out. It wasn't a trick.
Yeah, they have lawn chairs on roller coasters.
Yeah, they do. Yeah. It was a
the other video you had was the video where you're telling the story of you getting stuck in a window.
Yeah. Yeah.
Go check out his YouTube channel. He's awesome. He's a great animator. It's hilarious. Alright, so, Underbite, represent for Zephyr.
Hello.
Hi.
Hi.
Yes, so I play drums.
Now those are actually the sticks that I modified to play in suit, so
I'm not into nylon tips, but anyway. I'm into nylon tips, and you can catch me for tonight with a lovely Shoni. And Fox and Pepper, both myself and Terry, will be playing their entire sets today. We've only been cramming for it, Elton. So,
of course.
And so you should check it out tonight at 6 to 8:30. I am also an artist, illustrator, and graphic designer myself. You can find me on Twitter at Dragon Dragon. And I also create artwork for the YouTube channel Culturally Effed, which is still pumping out videos, mockumentaries, if you will. Talking Heads talking about the history of furry, and now we're talking about fursuit history. Latest episode, you can catch me talking about it.
Nice.
By all means.
Awesome. Well, I've got one.
Keep yours.
Oh, yeah, dueling
mics. No, that'll cost feedback.
Yeah. I am Roshoni the Rock and Roll Dragon, and I've been doing this for a couple of years now, and let's see, I have a performance tomorrow night. Well, tonight! Wow!
Tonight.
Whoa!
I am that far gone right now. I have performance at 6 p.m. in May events, and then I'll be doing a couple songs with these guys at the end of their set as well. I have a YouTube channel that is literally called The Rock and Roll Dragon. Same thing with my Twitter. With Twitter, it's one word, though. I'm just about almost to 1,000 subscribers. And if you guys have heard, YouTube changed their policy about monetization. You have to have at least 1,000 subscribers and at least like a certain number of watch hours, like per month or per year, to even qualify for monetization. I would love to, who would want to quit their job and do YouTube?
But I never thought of that.
If you guys would like to share around my information, I actually have some business cards attached to that amplifier over there, a little case on the top if you want to grab one. If you would like to spread the word about the Rock and Roll Dragon, that would be amazing. I'm trying to get myself out at conventions, at more events and stuff like that. I'm actually, surprisingly, guest of honor at Fur Reality in Ohio. Thank you for that. It's my first ever chance like being fully invited as a guest of honor to a convention, and I hope to put on another good show come October. All right, so now we have you, the last guy
I'm here for you. Don't mind me. Hi, I'm Texas Scum. You can find me on Twitter at Shy Scum Shaman.
Shy Scum Shaman?
Yep.
Shy Scum Shaman. That is a
mouthful. It is a mouthful. I don't post often because I'm kind of bad about it, but
same.
I'm going to try. For you, few people, I'll try. I'm currently trying to get my room sound treated so I can do some recording and maybe write this better. These guys, top tier. Me, trash tier. Keep looking down. Once you can't look down any further, look down a little further. That's
hey, this is not a self-deprecation.
No, but I do my best.
I find all creators eye to eye. We're all doing something wrong.
Well, thank you guys for attending the panel. Really appreciate you guys coming out.
Ask us questions if you want to do one-on-one. I gotta go check to see if Mike Trump's posted.